This is Ham Radio Now, episode 232, from Navassa to Palmyra and beyond. I guess I stole that from Bed Bath and Beyond. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and I am going to be talking to legendary Bob Allphin, K4UEE. It's a long conversation. This is about a two-hour show, I think. I haven't put it all together yet, but I've already had the conversation. I'm doing the intro. There's a little coda thing. Lots of stuff. We're going to talk about Navassa. We're going to talk about what's coming up with Palmyra, other DXpeditions, how to do DXpeditions, how to work DXpeditions. And I think you're going to get a lot out of it if you stick with it. So that's going to be coming up in a moment. But first, I'm going to talk to another fella about the Puerto Rico ARRL convention that's coming up the end of the month. We'll get to that in just a second. The first thing I need to get to is, as usual, Arvin's part of the deal. He's our chief financial officer. If you enjoy the programs, hamradionow.tv. Just stop by the website and you can make a contribution. You can join the Patreon and help us monthly, however you want to do it. End of sales pitch. So before we get to Bob Allphin, I'm going to head down to Puerto Rico and talked to Angel Santana, WP3GW, who's the PIO for Puerto Rico, and they got a convention that he has been beating the heck on me to talk about, so let's do that. And I think what we should begin with is to identify who you are. Who am I talking to?
Okay, thank you, Gary. Well, my name is Angel Santana, or Angel, as you wish. My call sign is WP3GW. I'm a true radio operator for 15 years, and right now the PIC for the section of Puerto Rico, the ARRL.
You're the public information coordinator for the Puerto Rico section.
Yes.
And the reason that we're talking is that you have been very persistent in communicating with me about your convention coming up. You're doing a great job of that. And so we're here to talk about that a little bit. And I think it is flattering that you think that getting some people who watch Ham Radio Now to hear about the convention, which is coming up the end of the month, will actually drive people down to Puerto Rico. So that's very nice. I don't know that that's going to happen, but it's nice of you to think so.
No, but in a way, we want to promote that. Well, that we are now. Fourth year in the world, we're having our own convention, the ARRL type, because we normally had a HamFest. We normally have HamFest here, which is mostly on Sundays, mainly. But then this was a HamFest called the Grand HamFest del Norte, the Great HamFest of the North. It was then evolved when the group who sponsored it, the Caribbean Amateur Radio Group, got with another one, the Puerto Rico Amateur Radio League, and then they combined their efforts to convince into the AR Puerto Rico State Convention.
I'm going to put up a couple of websites. This first one is the ARRL's own website and the notice of the Puerto Rico State Convention. And the dates are January 29th, Friday through 31st, so the very end of the month, and it's a three-day deal. Mm-hmm. And this is the actual website. Your convention, and we're counting down as we record this: 19 days, 19 hours, 52 minutes, and 21 seconds. 2018. It's relentless. It's coming at you. You got to be ready.
Yeah, and ready? I'm preparing all the press releases to put down on every media outlet over here in the island.
All right, so let me dial down the website a little bit farther. I'm coming across this thing called Iron Ham above various pictures that are showing what the convention looks like. What is this Iron Ham thing, Iron Ham competition?
Okay, I'm not sure if it has been done in the United States, but this is a first here in Puerto Rico. It's like the same as idea as the Iron Man, Iron Man concept.
Yeah, Iron Man is a triathlon, I guess. It's a huge endurance, physical endurance thing.
Okay, so taking the concept of the Iron Man, concept to bring into ham radio. It's three parts also.
What is going to be going on the rest of the convention? What other kinds of stuff do you have set up for people?
Okay, well, we're going to have the convention is 2 days. The 29th is going to be a VIP in a city in Arecibo. It's going to be a VIP reception. Then on the other day, the 2 days of the convention, we're going to have, on the 2 days, we're going to have examinations for our local ARRL-VEC team. The 2 days at 9 a.m., we're going to have some speakers. His name is Edwin. He resides in the United States. He's going to be speaking about V-Star. We're going to have two antennas, one with our local Carlos Roy, the before AOH. And we're going to have Tim Duffy also, K3 Lima Romeo, who gave Concert University Caribbean Nation last year. He's going to bring speak about emergency antennas. And we're going to have invited from the ARRL this year, Chris Imlay. He's going to be speaking about the Amateur Radio Parity Act.
Okay, because, cool.
Yeah. Yeah, because what happens is we have we call a congressman at large. We call him here the commission resident. So I understand that there are other congressmen at large from other territories of the United States. When we spoke to, have friends that exposed to him about the Amateur Radio Parity Act, he said, okay. He said, I'll support it. They have voice. They don't have vote, but at least one voice helps. So we're going to be speaking about the Amateur Radio Parity Act.
I've only been in Puerto Rico very briefly. I was there to get off an airplane and get on a cruise ship and got to spend a little bit of time at the very eastern end of the island. And I think I turned on my handy talkie and I came across a couple of repeaters and everybody was speaking Spanish, of course. By the way, hola amigo, uh-huh. ¿Cómo está? We'll use up all my Spanish in one phrase.
Todo bien, gracias, Gary.
But Puerto Rico is a vacation destination for a lot of people. You know, it's Caribbean. It's warm in the wintertime and in the summertime.
Yes.
Compared to a lot of the U.S. where it's going to be cold.
Yes.
So
360 days plus of summer we have over here.
Yeah, all year long, summer all year long. Tell me a little bit about a ham doing a vacation in Puerto Rico. What will they encounter in terms of both ordinary tourist stuff and specifically ham radio?
Okay, well, basically when they come over here, they want to go mostly to Old San Juan because of its historic importance. We have castles, we have old fortifications. This, Old San Juan was once surrounded by City Hall also. There are hotel casinos. As of recently, we have a new convention center. There's some countryside viewing also, some countryside viewing. And yes, you can bring your handy talkie. There are pretty much repeaters right now on the air. Some of them are linked on networks. And you can yourself, and don't worry about the language, because anyway, if you come and identify yourself, someone is going to receive you on your English language.
So if you, yes, when you first get on when you first get on the air on the repeaters, you're going to hear mostly people speaking in Spanish. But if you break in Spanish and give your call and say English, please, no hablo español, then people will be happy to talk to you in English.
No, maybe you can give your call sign if you say your call sign in native English. So, okay, and I have to pause. Okay, un amigo aquí de Estados Unidos, alguien hablando en inglés, just give him space. So we speak to him. Yeah, I have come across and have like at least twice communicated with people on repeaters, and we have met eye to eye about QSOs.
Yeah, so you'll come see people live and in person. And hams do that a lot when folks are traveling. You'll come see them in person. Puerto Rico is not only a territory of the U.S., ham radio-wise, you are your own DX entity. You count for DXCC. When you get on the air on HF, do you find yourself in the middle of pileups a lot? It's not the most rare DX entity, but it does. DX entities are DX entities. People tend to jump on them. You end up as the object of pileups a lot.
Sometimes it depends on backgrounds. If the band is open to the United States, maybe if we're the only ones. And contesting, sometimes we are sold very much for sweepstakes. To give you an example, because we participate in sweepstakes. And by the way, like 15 years ago, there was a 10-year in a row where radio station WP3R was on top of sweepstakes. So let's give you an advantage point. People like to be also here. It's important being here in the Caribbean. When the CQ, WPX worldwide, they sometimes come over here, they participate because the propagation, I don't know, we have a world where we can get signals from all over the world.
Well, I think that's pretty much it. We want to make sure everybody understands that you've got your convention coming up on January 29th, 30th, and 31st. So it's not too late if somebody has been experiencing, especially out west, some of that brutal winter that... that some of the country has had. My part of the country has been perpetual summer this year so far. We've had a couple of cold days. Today it's like 63 degrees outside on January 10th.
I've been paying attention to the weather issues, I think, or interesting weather you're having because of somebody called the boy. I'm sorry, El Niño.
Yeah. So for you folks out west, particularly who've been just hammered with winter, head on down to Puerto Rico at the end of the month, and you'll have some summertime. It is, let's see, there was a map here on the ARRL's website. Let me see.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Is it in the same place it was last year out by Arecibo? Yeah, it is.
Yeah, it is in the city of Atillo, the Francisco Pancho de Ida Coliseum in Atillo. Yes, it's pretty near the coast.
Okay. And there's...
So that's
yeah, and there's Arecibo there. So do you have another observatory tour lined up for this year?
No, we don't have this year. They're going to visit a place where they process, I think it's cheese. I'm not sure what it is. But if you want to visit the observatory, personally, you can do it because they have visiting hours over there. So it's no problem if you want to visit the Arecibo Observatory.
Okay.
And also KP4 for whiskey is going to be also on the air these days promoting the convention. Just in case you hear Kilo Papa, the official convention, special event station.
Okay, so you got some cool stuff happening and some warm weather to enjoy it in. Good luck with the convention and thanks for pestering me. I can't do this for every Hamfest and convention that's coming along and it's probably not that valuable for you because like I say it's flattering that you think that folks watching this program will book a flight and a hotel and come down to the convention. And I don't know that you'll get one person out of it, but you've got some people who are becoming more aware of what Puerto Rico Ham Radio is all about anyway.
That, what you said in the last is what the man proposed. That's my job, PIC. I have to promote what we do.
Yeah.
Look, you see what I have here in the back?
That's the silver antenna.
Yeah.
I got one of those.
2011.
I grabbed the closest plaque I could find, and it wasn't the silver antenna. I've got a silver antenna. This is from Tapper. Tapper gave me a plaque for making videos and stuff. Somewhere around here, I've got a silver antenna. So we are silver antenna awardees. My friend, that's quite an honor.
Mm-hmm. Colleagues, yeah.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much. And again, like I said, I can't do this for everybody, but you beat on me hard enough that here you are. And you have a story to tell about hamming in a somewhat more unusual place, and I'm glad to hear about that. Gracias, amigo. Vaya con Dios. What other Spanish phrases can I come up with from high school? I'm not too sure. Oh, let me introduce you to El Gato. Did I get that right? Maui Mouse?
Yeah, from Gato,
Named after another island, the Maui Island over in Hawaii, but El Gato.
Maui, okay.
Although she's female. Is she La Gata?
Yeah, La Gata.
La Gata. Okay, so Maui, you are La Gata.
Yeah.
It's good talking to you, and have fun at the convention. Thanks a lot.
Okay. Thank you, Gary. Gracias. Everybody invited to pass. We're passing vacation over here in Puerto Rico the last weekend. And anything, if you would like to contact me, just in case, I also speak to other PICs also and reflector. If you by any chance need anything in Spanish, any translation, I'm available. WP3GW at ARRL.net.
All right. Yes, take a vacation. Head to Puerto Rico. It's going to be beautiful. And tell Angel Gary sent you. Okay, now, Bob Allphin, K4UEE. You probably know by now that I edited the DVD that has been on sale for a while, since around Thanksgiving, for the K1N Navassa DXpedition. And so I've been working with Bob Allphin for a while, and I've wanted to do this show ever since making that DVD, because there were so many things that I learned about DXpeditions. I've never been on one. I rarely work them. I listen to them a little bit, listen to the big pileups. You know, I'm a longtime ham, but working DX has never been a big part of my ham radio experience. If I come across it, I work it. It's kind of cool to work somebody and get a signal back, especially when you're competing with other folks in a pileup and make that contact. I especially like doing it from my car. So you got a big pileup or even a medium pileup, and you beat that pileup from a mobile running 100 watts and in my case, a tar heel antenna. That's kind of cool. Doesn't matter where they are. But I learned a lot more about working these DXpeditions from the vantage point of their end, as it was communicated to me by looking at all the raw footage that Bob had shot from my K1N and me editing it down to from about 5 hours down to the 45-minute program on the DVD, and from listening to their talks at Dayton and some other hamfests that I've picked up some of these talks at. So I haven't been real big in the DX world here on Ham Radio Now, but a little bit. So if you're here from that world and you haven't been by Ham Radio Now, but this has attracted you, then welcome. Glad to have you here. Maybe broaden your horizons a little bit and watch some of the other shows. I was going to ask you to explain who you were, but you've got those banners in the background that people are going to start recognizing, FT5ZM and K1N from Navassa. So now people know, I mean, all the DXers know who you are, yeah. but a lot of the folks watching the program might not know who you are. So tell you what, so that I can get you centered in the frame, let me have you move your camera and get yourself all in the middle. And then, yeah, I can do one of these custom Ham Radio Now split screens and, we'll find out who you are. Tell the Ham Radio Now audience a little bit about who you are. Just it would take the rest of the show to explain everything about who you are.
Well, I got my start at age 14, like many people did. And I got interested in radio via the Boy Scouts when I built that crystal set to get the merit badge. I think one of the differences is that when I heard music and voice coming through the air, I thought it was magic, and I was fascinated by it. And in fact, here I am 50-some years later, 57 years later. I still think it's magic, Gary.
Anyway, me too.
I was hooked on radio. It took me 4 or 5 years to get the code speed and find somebody to act as my Elmer. But I got licensed in 58, and then my dad, who was in the military, was transferred to Okinawa. And the family went with him, and Okinawa at that point was a separate DXCC entity. In the early 70s, it reverted to Japan, but back then it was KR6. And I had a DX40 and a Nightkit R100 receiver, and I was big DX.
Wow.
First time that I had been on the other end of the pileup, and I got to say, it got me hooked. So I've been doing that ever since. I retired about 16, 17 years ago. And basically, my job now is to organize, put on DXpeditions. And my specialty is to put on DXpeditions to the top 10 most wanted. I know this sounds a little weird, but I've activated 11 of the top 10. I'll let that sink in for a minute.
Yes, I'm trying to do the math, and it's not calculating. as my friend Jeff AC4ZO says, we got some rubber math going on here.
Yeah, I know.
So how does that work? 11 of the top 10.
The answer, of course, is that once we get there and operate, they're not in the top 10 anymore. And
for a while.
And for a while, usually about 10 years. And then, something else moves into the top 10. So we've got one of the things we're going to talk about today is the fact that four of the current top 10 are going to be activated in the next 90 days. So I think most active DXers are very much aware of that, and they need all or some of these, for the DXCC credits. But for those people that may not be active DXers but still have an interest in seeing how far their signal will go, this would be a great time to get on the air and try to work these folks, because it could easily be another 10, 15, or even 20 years before they're on the air again, Gary.
So that brings me to what I want to, we can't lead off with it because we've already started, but let's pick up with this one. And this is the DXpedition that folks are actually on their way to right now. I've been watching some of the Facebook posts, and the guys are gathering in Hawaii right now for K5P, the Palmyra Atoll DXpedition. You were going to go on that, right?
Yes. Originally, there were to be 12 members, but Fish and Wildlife and the Nature Conservancy, who control the islands, cut us back to 9 because the old World War II runway there has been decertified or declassified, or in any case, the status has been changed, so different and smaller aircraft are required. So they went down from 12 to 9. I had already been there one time about 15 years ago, and I thought it would be best if I just stepped aside and let somebody who had not been to Palmyra go on the trip. So, now that they're on their way, I kind of regret my decision. I'd like to go. It's a beautiful place. I mean, it is. It's if you look at the website, you'll see that it's the perfect example of a Pacific island. It's just a beautiful place.
It does look real pretty. I'm going to look at a little bit more of the Google Maps stuff on it in just a minute. You have your last big DXpedition was Navassa,
right?
That you have on the wall there, K1N, and you and I collaborated on making the DVD, and we'll talk about that a little bit later on, but I want to stick with Palmyra for a little bit. And in fact, I've got, let's see where it is in the world. Cause, the guys who are the DXers all understand, but a lot of the guys in the audience will say, well, I don't, where is this? So the little Google map thing is, sitting on Palmyra. There we go. Cool. Thank you, Google. That's helpful. This is Hawaii. And all these little stars are places that are just part of my ordinary Google map. I've been to Hawaii a bunch. So it's, what, about 1,000 miles southwest of Hawaii?
Exactly. Yeah, and more south than west, but
yeah,
it's about 1,000 miles. Uh-huh.
So there it is compared to the U.S. and then compared to Asia and finally Europe way over there. So now let me make everybody dizzy and we'll try to dial in. Wish I could do this like they do in the movies, but I don't have that kind of stuff. So this is what the Palmyra group, a bunch of little islands all kind of grouped together. And the neat thing about Google is that it shows you under sea all the mountains and stuff that are not breaking the surface. And then these little atolls and islands are just the surface of the top of a probably pretty darn tall mountain that is just breaking the surface of the ocean.
Yeah, so I think the water there is probably 15,000, 3 or 4 miles deep.
Yeah. So
those are big mountains.
Yeah. But you only see a very little bit of them. And there's that runway that you were talking about.
Right.
And unlike Navassa, Navassa was an uninhabited island. It had a lighthouse that had been decommissioned, and there was nobody permanently there. Haitian fishermen visit just about every day, but nobody permanently there. It looks like this is sort of inhabited. There are some folk. It looks like this stuff is regular dwellings, and people are there all the time.
Right. There are now. I was there about 15 years ago, and what happened is that the Nature Conservancy wanted to purchase the island. It was owned by the Fulyard family out of Honolulu, and I guess it came for sale. And the Nature Conservancy wanted to preserve it because it is a beautiful place, and you know, the wildlife and the flora and the fauna and everything is interesting and beautiful and worth, you know, taking care of.
That runway does look pretty rough.
Yeah. So what they did is they built a camp, kind of a VIP type camp on the island, and then started flying in millionaires and mostly billionaires.
Okay, so that would be you.
To get, you know, to show them the island and get them to make a commitment to the Nature Conservancy so that they could afford to buy it. And in fact, I got to see all of that set up. It was pretty impressive. And the week before I was there, Ted Turner had been on the island. So I don't know, you know, what came of that. But it was an interesting way to raise money to buy the island. So now the main island you see there is owned by the Nature Conservancy, but all of the rest of the islands are not owned by, but they are administered by Fish and Wildlife. They're owned by the United States, but administered by U.S. Fish and Wildlife.
Do you know where our hams are going to operate from? Do you know where they're planning to set up?
Yeah, if you could scoot in again there, I'm looking at this thing like you are. You, by the way, you must have a better connection than I. That's an awfully clear picture. There's a large building there. And if I remember correctly, right there, just zoom in. They will be operating in that building there. And the antennas will be set up on that that area that's probably about 150 by 100 feet, something like that, you know, to the southwest corner of your picture there.
Okay, so we've got this empty spot down here, that probably where they're going to set things up.
Correct.
Okay, so this is considerably more comfortable than what you guys had in Navassa.
Well, yeah, there's infrastructure, buildings. They'll be taking their meals in a cafeteria arrangement. They'll be sharing the KP duties with the personnel that are stationed there. There is a proper privy. That's a PP. And we didn't have any of that.
So Mike Mars is not going to have to do a latrine duty this time.
Say that again?
Mike Mars is not going to have to do latrine duty this time?
No, he's not.
That's an inside joke for the folks that have seen the Navassa DVD.
Seen the video, yeah. I still get tickled when I see that. But, you know, and they've got a roof over their head and that kind of thing. Of course, on Navassa, we had to take everything. We lived in tents. We ate MREs. We went to the bathroom behind a bush. And, you know, a whole different deal. I was kind of looking forward to going to Palmyra because it was going to be so much more civilized, so to speak.
Yeah, you'll step off the plane, unload the gear, set it up, and it'll be nice.
So, Actually, the gear, except for the radios and stuff, everything else, the antennas and all of that stuff, has been there for months. In fact, it was shipped on a barge from Honolulu in late March, right after Navassa, last year.
Okay, so they know it's sitting there waiting for them. It's all been...
You bet, yeah.
And this being a U.S. Possession... not nearly the customs considerations that you guys had in Navassa. The video spends some time with going through every little bit of the gear that you were bringing checked by Jamaica Customs because you went through Jamaica.
Yeah, It was the folks in Jamaica that that spent so much time going through all that stuff. That won't be the case here. There will be there are some special rules to make sure that no invasive species or seeds or, you know, small minuscule animals or something like that are carried onto the island. In fact, one of the things that the guys were required to do is take all of their clothing and freeze it in an effort to make sure that whatever might be sticking to it would be killed. And you know, when they get onto the island, it's not going to be bringing something in that they don't want there.
Yeah, I was going to ask about that because I saw on, I think, Jerry's WB9, what's Jerry's call sign?
WB9 Zulu, yeah. Zed.
Yeah, on his Facebook page, he was, and Craig K9CT, Craig is going to be the leader of this thing, talking about freezing their clothes. And I'm going, what? You just explained why. And actually, my wife Cindy told me about it because she's done a little bit of this stuff. That you have to do that. She talks about doing it on your way back because you may pick up bed bugs and stuff in some third world type countries. But you guys have to do it on the way in so that you don't bring anything in that they don't want there.
Correct. They're spending all their time trying to get rid of things that other people have brought in over the years. I might point out, just a matter of correction, there are two leaders. One is Craig K9 Charlie Tango, and the other is Lou N2TU, and they have shared the rather considerable work that's required to pull this thing together.
These DXpeditions, it's not all the same groups of people, but this one and Navassa and a few of that you've been involved in have a sort of a pool of people that seem to all be called upon or invited or volunteer to take part in these DXpeditions. It's sort of a consistent group of people. How do you decide who's going to run which show?
Well, it's usually the leader who has the final say in all of that. And I usually, what I like to do is have a co-leader because there's just so darn much work to do. And I also do the fundraising and the act as the treasurer. So I really need some help when I'm in charge. And we just sit down and we go back and forth and say, how about so-and-so and how about so-and-so? And we come up with a list and then we invite them. Now that the origin of that list basically goes back maybe 20 years. I mean, these are, for the most part, these are people that we have been on expeditions with before. We know how they react to different types of situations. We're comfortable that they're not going to get us in trouble or panic in a situation that, you know, where lives are at stake, or certainly someone can be injured if somebody, you know, kind of makes an error. And so we trust these people, and they're good operators. And the other thing that's required is that they've got to either be retired or have a job that allows them time off. I mean, I've been away on 3 6-week trips before, and two of those were after I retired. But it's hard to find somebody that not only can find that kind of time, but also we usually pay at least half of the costs, and these things can run $500,000. So that means that the 14 or 15 or 20 guys that are going have to put up, you know, $200,000 or $300,000 between them. And it's hard to find somebody that's got that kind of money, who's a good operator and who's got the time.
So that sort of leads into one of the questions I was going to ask. And by the way, I have to introduce my co-host for the program here. It's Maui Mouse, who decided she wanted to sit on the chair behind me, and she's probably going to be crawling around a little bit.
Kind of looks like a budding DXer there.
She's trying. I interviewed Chaz Cohn, W4GKF, right, shortly after your talk at Dayton last year. I was getting this Navassa fever from watching the talk that you and Glenn did, which, by the way, is a Ham Radio Now episode, if anybody wants to go take a look at that. And I discovered this 1972 DXpedition that had been out there. It turns out a lot of people had been to Navassa. It used to be a pretty common, easy place to go to, right, through the 70s and 80s and into the early 90s. And Chaz had been there, a much smaller operation. But
and a much smaller budget too.
Yeah, they were only there for a couple of days.
And they were there over a weekend, and I think you had to kick in $500.
Yeah, and Wayne Green went with him on that one.
Yeah,
but he was saying that the average age for the hams that were there were in their 30s, and now, as you were saying, and at the talk in Dayton, the average age of the hams that were there at Navassa last year was in their 60s. And you sort of explain why that is going to be the case with some of these things. But is there a replacement plan here for you guys that are going to be getting too old to do this?
Well, first of all, I'm never going to get too old to do it.
Okay.
I think maybe the difficulty and complexity of where I go is going to, you know, change. But I think I'll be doing this a long, long time. I think we have some responsibility to bring our replacements along, if you will. We haven't, in my view, we haven't done a real good job of that, but we really should start thinking about taking a new guy, a rookie, if you will, on every one of our trips, and kind of, you know, teach him the ropes, so to speak. But there are other groups worldwide, the French, the Italians, the Germans, and there's some American groups that are on these trips that we're going to talk about here in a few minutes, including Palmyra, who might be in that next generation. And in the case of a couple of these expeditions we're going to talk about, you know, they may find out they don't want to do it anymore after they go to these places. But, you know, they're stepping up, and every time you go out and do one of these things successfully, you come back and you say, here's what we learned, here's what we know to do next time, and here's what we know not to do next time. And so, you know, they just get better and better and more proficient. And then ultimately, then they've got to start worrying about replacing themselves.
Yeah, there's intermediate steps. I was thinking, well, maybe we need a DXpedition camp to get people going in something like this. But there's plenty of intermediate steps between these difficult, very expensive places to go to and going to a North Carolina coast island. You know, there's the hotel kind of DXpeditioning. There are ways to work your way up. I suppose those would be the folks that you're looking at, because it's the way you started too. You
know, you started. It is the way I started. I am contacted from time to time by somebody who says the same thing you said, Gary. You know, how come it's always the same? Well, you didn't word it this way, but how come it's always the same guys? And how does one get on the list? And the answer is, you've got to build yourself a ham radio resume. And, you know, as you pointed out, there's a lot of places in the world you can go. You can get on an airplane and fly to Jamaica or a number of places. I live in Atlanta, so there's probably 15 destinations where one stop or nonstop flights to the Caribbean. There's ham radio friendly hotels all over the Caribbean. Go down, set up for 3 or 4 days, put an antenna on the roof, and just get better at running pileups and fixing things when they break, and put that on your resume. And I might add, too, that if you're a physician or if you've got a special expertise of some kind that would help the entire team, it's not just about operating. It's there's a lot to be done and a lot of specialties required, that kind of thing should go on the resume as well.
One of the things that Chaz Cohen was mentioning to me was, and part of the reason why he didn't take up the potential opportunity to go back to Navassa this year, last year, is that he's not a triple threat. He is a phone operator. His CW skills aren't really good, and he doesn't have digital skills. And now if someone is going to go, they've got to be able to operate all those modes with at least good proficiency.
Yeah, I've got to be careful how I answer that because I'm not a digital enthusiast yet. Most of my buddies are, and they tell me it's fun and relaxing, and you can read a magazine while you're doing it. But my preference is CW. I'm a good phone operator. I did a lot of operating in the 80s and early 90s from the Caribbean in contests. In fact, set five world records, single band, single operator world records. So my operating skills are one of the pluses. But again, that's not the first thing people look at. At least that's not the first thing I look at when I'm trying to decide whether to bring somebody along. I think the most important thing, other than the fact that they've got the time and they've got the money, the most important thing is that I think they'll fit in. Because if you go to some place and you turn out to be a jerk and you're ruining everybody's trip, it's just not fair. It's not fair to them because they paid good money to be there. And, you know, because I made a mistake or somebody invited the wrong person, I feel like I'm responsible for them having a good time. So, I mean, I remember when we were just about to get on the helicopter and fly from our vessel onto Peter One in Antarctica. The last thing I said was, "Behave yourself, guys. Don't become jerks, or you will leave the island and go back and spend the expedition sitting on the boat."
Yeah. Sometimes you can send people away. Sometimes you're just kind of stuck there until it's all over with. Has that happened? Have you run into people that kind of wish you hadn't brought along?
That was years ago. That's why we've got our A list now.
Yeah.
Those guys are on the C list.
Now this group of people, this is not a formal organization. It's not a club, an incorporation or anything like that. It's just, you know who you are.
Yeah. I have a corporation. It's a 501c7, and that is the umbrella that these expeditions are done under. And the reason for doing it, other than some form of limited liability, but the main reason is that contributions made to the expedition through the incorporated entity are not taxable to me, but they're not deductible because it's a C7. So we didn't go all the way and get a C3, but there is an umbrella, if you will, a corporate umbrella that is over these things, as it should be. But there's not a group of guys who are part of a club, and that club is the one that always goes.
Yeah. So your corporation is to handle the financial stuff and the business stuff, but you don't sit around a board meeting and say, let's figure out how we're going to do this. But you do that, but not as really part of the corporation, just as part of the group.
We do what's required by law to maintain that tax exempt status.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. I want to dial down another website here. This is your website. Now, you, in addition to doing these things, you've produced a lot of DVDs. So this is the top of your DVD page. I'm going to go to the bottom first. This is the first one that you produced. Well, it may be the second based on the date.
I think the first one we did was K5K. Anyway, I'm not sure why they're in that particular order, but
we can blame Chaz for that.
Yeah.
he builds your website.
He's a webmaster, so.
Yeah, but, so I think K5K is going to be right above it. Kingdom
Reef. That was in 2000, and
that'll be the well-known DXpedition. This this one down here to Burkina Faso. Is that well known?
That's just really a contest, CQ Worldwide CW contest that I was invited on, and I took my camera along and got some really cool shots. First time I'd been to Africa, and came back and said, you know, this is very interesting to me. Maybe it's interesting to others. And it turns out that it's not my most popular video, DVD, but a lot of people compliment me on it and say, you know, you gave me a view of Africa that I've never really seen before.
Okay. But the well-known DXpedition, that's the first one you did the video of.
Yeah.
Was Kingman Reef.
I believe that's right, yeah.
And
about 15 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Yep, I'll slide up the list here. Let's see.
This is 2002, and those are the two places that South Sandwich and South Georgia that are going to be activated in the next 30 days.
Okay.
And so we were on the last expedition that went to those two places. And that was 14 years ago now.
So they have come up on the list of needed.
Yes, that's right. They worked their way back up. And it's kind of interesting. All four of these places that we're going to talk about here that are coming on that are in the top 10, I happen to be part of the group that activated them the last time they were activated.
Yeah. Do you know the guys who are going to this one?
To South Sandwich and South Georgia.
I mean, probably know everybody who's involved in this.
I think there's one guy on that team that I've never met.
Okay, so it's the world of world class DXpeditioners is not very big, and you probably all know each other.
That's not entirely true, but. I've met most of the Germans. I've met the French in Visalia this year. Of course, the American fellows I've met at various conventions. That's kind of where we get together and, you know, trade notes and pat each other on the back and say what a great job they did at so-and-so.
So is it more camaraderie or competition? Is there circulation among the people to the various DXpeditions? Or is it you're cordial? But wait till you have to actually perform.
Well, we try not to get in each other's way.
I'm putting you on the spot here. I'm going to watch this.
A little bit. For example, I'll give you a great example. It's well known that we were working on activating DXpeditiion and Navassa. And we in 2002, we formed the KP-15 project, and the objective was to negotiate with Fish and Wildlife and get those things activated. It took us 7 years to get DXpeditiion on the air. That was in 2009. And then another six years to get Navassa done. All of the other groups basically understood that we were concentrating on this and working on this, and they just, you know, worked on something else. And we try to respect each other in that regard. There have been instances where two groups would be going to the same place at the same time, and then they have a little discussion about who we really don't want two going, so who's going to go. But I've never had that problem. One of the reasons is we really go to rare places, so there's not a lot of groups that have the expertise or the fundraising ability or connections or whatever to get permission to go to these top teners. But it's kind of a friendly, I won't say competition, it's just a friendly sharing type of thing.
Maybe a bit of a rivalry.
A bit, yeah.
I mean, because you all know what you can do, but you want to make you want to in similar situation, at least in terms of duration. You got a competition for how many contacts can be made. You know, that's the ultimate keeping score, I guess. How many total contacts are made?
Yeah, and I think we pretty much hold the record on that. So. I don't see much in the way of competition. I'd be real surprised if they even get close to some of our numbers.
Okay, so here's the next one that you produced, Peter 1. I think everybody's going to recognize what that is.
Yeah, I hope so. That took 3 years out of my life. Basically, that's all I did except sleep and eat and play a little bit of golf and go to church for 3 years, and we finally got it done.
Let me, there's a preview video here. Let me dig into that a little bit. Give folks an idea if I can make it. There we go.
Finally have a clear shot of the entire radio suite of the plane there. The best we had yesterday was maybe half of it was uncovered. It was not where we wanted to be. And now the portion of the plane where we want to be is uncovered. They're flying exactly where we want to go.
So this is your heading into the
survey and pick the spots.
Heading into the island, and this is a boat trip that began, and then you had to make the last leg on a helicopter, it looks like.
Yeah, we sat offshore for about 36 hours waiting for the weather to clear. There's a 5,000-foot volcano there that basically creates its own weather. And we had to contend with that the whole time. Here we are checking for crevices or crevasses.
And this shows that not every place you go is warm and tropical.
It shows it very well, yes.
If you have your druthers, which do you prefer?
I've got to say that the Antarctic region, I've been down there three times now. It is addictive. It's like going to another planet, Gary. It's everything is so different, so beautiful. It's like going, you know, out of this world.
So it is probably a little more dangerous and maybe a little less comfortable, but a bigger challenge?
Probably the biggest challenge, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's, and it is uncomfortable. I remember it wasn't too long after this, we started putting up the antennas and the wind was blowing so hard that the guy next to me, we were trying to communicate about what to do, and we literally were, our heads were 12 inches apart and we couldn't hear what we were saying.
This ultimately ended up quite successful. You got on the air.
Yeah.
And, if anybody wants to see more about it, let me dial back up here a little bit. It would be nice if Google would cooperate. There we go. There's a DVD.
I didn't know you were going to help me sell my DVDs, Gary.
Why not? That's what, you know, I think that first of all, having those DVDs is very cool. And when I started my Ham Radio Now and my ARVN stuff making DVDs, I looked at the media landscape in ham radio and it was pretty bleak with the bright, shining difference of the DXpedition DVDs, the guys that you have, the ones you've made and the ones that, who's that fella in Singapore?
James Brooks.
Yeah, he's produced some very professional stuff. Produced some good stuff.
He's kind of my mentor.
Yep. So there were those and not really much else in the ham radio sphere. So I wasn't able to do DX stuff. So I produced other things, last minute field day and a few other things, and then got into this online thing, Ham Radio Now. So looking at the DVDs is pretty cool. And I think they've been fairly popular, sold okay for you, I guess.
Yeah, we're covering our costs, and if there's anything left over, it goes into my next DXpedition pot.
Okay, Guinea, West Africa.
This was another CQ Worldwide contest. The group of guys that for 20 years, every CQ Worldwide CW contest, every November, these fellows would go to West Africa, and they would operate 2 years in a location and then move to another location and operate, you know, two successive years. And I got invited along a couple of times. And again, it's a part of the world I haven't spent much time in, and I was just fascinated. This particular trip, part of the trip, in fact, I think we show it early on, we had to move our equipment from an earlier QTH. It was stored in Bamako in Mali. And we had to drive about 500 miles through bandit country. We hired a couple of gun-toting, in fact, you may have a picture, a couple of gun-toting guards, and it was something I'd never done before, and frankly, I hope I don't have to do it again. It was kind of frightening.
It's the voodoo dudes.
Well, it's the voodoo contest group, and they refer to themselves as the voodoos, which is kind of cute. And I don't know how much further, but you're going to see these armed guards here in a moment.
So this is another one of those warm destinations.
Yes.
How did you come to be the guy that does the videos? Not been your business, right?
No. It's just, it goes back to James Brooks. You know, he's been doing this a long time. In fact, it's his profession, videos and commercials. I think that's a cute shot.
So he's like me. He's done television production for
He's in the business. There's one of the guards, yeah. And I just got fascinated by it. It's such a better medium than just still photographs. So it makes you feel like you're there, and the photographs just don't do that. Yep. So
some of these parts of the video are kind of travelogue.
Yeah,
it's not all ham radio.
Well, the greatest compliment I can get is for a male ham radio operator come up to me after a presentation and say, "Bob, my wife enjoyed it." And then I know that I've done my job and made it interesting to all parties. It's not just radio. It's about the adventure.
Yeah. Our Navassa DVD isn't so much travelogue as some of the others are.
Right.
Desecheo was the place that you went while you were waiting to go to Navassa. Not exactly.
Well,
but it was you had two places that you were working with Fish and Wildlife to go to. Desecheo, which is just west of Puerto Rico.
Yeah.
And Navassa was just south.
Well, Navassa is...
Well, other side of Cuba.
Hundreds of miles away, yeah. But,
okay.
But they were both administered and controlled by Fish and Wildlife people in Puerto Rico. And the easiest expedition of the two was Desecheo, and we got our permission there first. We used helicopters. It didn't cost that much, and it's a short flight, and it was quite an adventure, but a major breakthrough with Fish and Wildlife.
Yeah, so this is maybe a good spot to talk about the Fish and Wildlife thing a little bit. You and Glenn actually at the Dayton Hamvention, you spent your portion of the talk that you shared with Glenn talking about how you got there. There's this easier to get to the moon than it was to get to Navassa that you were mentioning, because it just in terms of time.
Yeah, it's.
But almost as expensive.
I suppose, yeah. No, I think it took, from the time President Kennedy announced that we were going to the moon by the end of the 60s, I think it was 9 years or something like that. It took us 13 years to get to Navassa. So the conclusion is it's harder to get to Navassa than to the moon. And that brought a couple of laughs from the crowd. Others were still scratching their head trying to do the math.
Yep. But it was, what made it difficult was not that it was hard to get to. They're not easy to get to, but you book a helicopter and you can get there. Yeah. They are under the protection now of U.S. Fish and Wildlife, and that's a political challenge. Now, to hear the whole story, just head back to Ham Radio Now, and I don't remember what episode it was. It's not too far back in the list, and you can see
206.
Yeah, like okay, episode 205 or so, and you can see Glenn and Bob talking in detail about how this all happened. But now you have, I guess, would you call it a working relationship with Fish and Wildlife? Palmyra is a Fish and Wildlife area. Was your relationship key to those guys being able to go there?
No. I have stayed, you know, we talked earlier about competition and trying to stay out of each other's way. While they were deferring to me in the Caribbean, I was deferring to others in the Pacific. I did counsel with them, however, and I am told that my counsel was somewhat helpful. I know that what I would have done, and I think what they did, was go to a nature conservancy who's always trying to raise money and say, how much is it going to cost?
Okay.
And then can we afford it?
So it's not like there's now a ham radio connection inside Fish and Wildlife. Anybody who wants to do something at one of these places is kind of working on their own.
They're kind of working on their own. I am thinking about turning my attention to the Pacific now. There's a couple of places there that will be in the top 10 again very soon. I've got some contacts in Honolulu. And I'm pretty sure that the people here in Atlanta that were helpful to us in the Caribbean could get me an appointment. So we'll just have to see. You know, the idea, essentially, Gary, is that Fish and Wildlife is operating under reduced funding and has been for a number of years. And yet, at the same time, particularly in the Pacific, they've got these wildlife refuges that are literally thousands of miles apart and no way to get to them. So they're inhibited, you know, in doing their job. They've got a responsibility to look after the island and the wildlife and protect it, or rid it of invasive species, et cetera, but no budget or transportation to get there. So, you know, I say, look, come, you know, let's make a partnership. You go with us, you do what you need to do, we'll do what we need to do, and it'll benefit everybody.
So to some extent, you're paying to bring some of their personnel along with you.
Yes.
At Navassa, you needed, well, they wanted to send personnel for your protection and for the island's protection from you.
Yeah. Well, what you didn't talk about, or what we didn't talk about in the video, is the fact that there were three biologists along as well. And they were out every day doing what they do. But there were also four or five of the law enforcement people who were protecting us from the island and the island from us, as you say. But there was a lot accomplished during that visit, not the least of which was enhancing the relationship between the Fish and Wildlife representatives and the Haitian fishermen, who have been fishing those waters since, 1900.
So they needed to understand each other a little bit better. And it sounds like
correct.
They had the opportunity to do that.
Correct. And find out, you know, it always boils down to just finding out that the other guy is a good guy too.
Yep. I was at a meeting a couple nights ago of the Potomac Valley Radio Club's chapter that's down here in Raleigh. That's Contest Club on the Eastern Seaboard.
Right.
And they the reason I went was they were playing the DVD, and no one fell asleep, and only a couple of guys had to leave. I told them that that I wouldn't be offended if anybody had to leave because of timing, but I would be offended if someone fell asleep, and I'd be really offended if they snored. So
you threatened them.
Yes. And
successfully.
Yeah, and nobody fell asleep. One of the guys was there was Will, AA4XX, I think, who had been to Navassa.
AA4NC.
AA4NC, okay. And he had been there in 1993, so, or 92. One of the last two groups to visit before you guys did, before that long dry spell in being able to go there. He just got Coast Guard permission, and they said, you will probably die, And if you do, we won't be there to pick up your body.
Yeah. And if that's okay with you, then just not miss.
Yeah. Which is kind of the same thing that Chaz got in 1972.
Exactly. That the Coast Guard was, during those years, there was visits to the island every couple of years, it seemed.
Yeah.
That all changed when Fish and Wildlife took over.
Yep. So what Will was saying was that the Haitians were there just about every day, and they were not a threat, at least not then. And they were very helpful. He was talking, their operation did go all the way up to the lighthouse, which is quite a walk.
One of the few operations that's gone to the trouble of making that walk. Usually they just operate right there at Lulu Bay and set up their antennas. You know, it's a short walk to there, but it's down the hill and Europe is always blocked. You know, for Will and those guys to carry all that stuff up there. In fact, what he's probably inferring is that they had some help from the Haitian fellows.
They did. Yeah. That's what he said, was that, that those guys carried some of the big heavy generators and, you know, and trade for material and stuff.
Right.
But they were not a threat. They weren't someone they needed protection from. Now this could be a different world today.
No,
kind of hard to tell.
I would say that's still the case. It's just that Fish and Wildlife couldn't take any chances.
Yeah. They're now responsible for you as opposed to the Coast Guard saying, good luck.
Yeah, that's right.
So the relationship that you built up through the KP-15 project that spent years and one of the problems I think you ran into is that personnel change in Fish and Wildlife. So you build a relationship with somebody and then administrations change or careers change and they're gone and you just start over again.
Or they retire or they leave the service or something like that. So we, the people that helped us with Desecheo in 2009 moved on almost immediately after that. And said, I'm being transferred. I can't help you anymore. Good luck.
so you set up a whole new group of associations, which is why there was that big gap.
That's correct.
Desecheo.
I must say that, once you sit down in front of these folks and they sit down in front of you and you find out that you're just regular people, and that there's nothing nefarious going on. We just have this hobby, and they understand the hobby because they're bird watchers.
Yeah, you talked about that.
Yeah, they've got, you know, they're trying to see all the different species in the world, and they've got a top 10 list, and it kind of sounds like DXCC to me. So once you find you have a common ground, And you make a couple of points with them, and they make a couple of points with you, then it all shifts to how can we do this? How can we get it done?
And as you're saying, you have some things to offer them, transportation, financing, and you are able to prove that you don't desecrate these pristine environments. Well, I'm not sure that Navassa could be considered pristine, but there's wildlife they want to protect. You don't do anything that messes that up. You take care of it.
No, we're just, first of all, that's not in our nature. It's not in the nature of any of the people that go along. And secondly, it would be a huge mistake. But that has happened, however. It happened in Navassa. In Desecheo. And one of the reasons that they were reluctant to let hams back on there, because there was a little bit of that trashing stuff going on. It's just ridiculous and set us back. But we know better than that.
Okay. I'm going to head back to your website here for a minute. So there's Desecheo. You didn't just sit back and wait for Navassa to happen. You went someplace else.
Difficult
to get to.
I got to keep my skills up. I was invited to join this expedition and then invited to be one of the co-leaders. All the spade work done here was done in Colombia, and again it involved a local Colombian fella meeting with the right people and convincing them that this, you know, all the good reasons why this needed to be done and get that permission. And then once they had everything cleared, since he'd never really done one of these before, he said, well, I need some help. I need somebody to get the team together and get the radios together and help with the planning and all of that. And he said, I'll take care of things down here in Colombia, and you take care of the other stuff, Bob. And I said, that sounds good to me, because that's a place I've always wanted to go to. And so that was in 2012, and that was a tough one. We had, it was just the tippy top of a mountain, a 12,000-foot mountain, and 1,000 feet was sticking up above the ground, and it was darn near straight up.
Go back to that picture here. Yeah, you can see from the cover. This is the DVD cover. You can see that it's not a lot of beaches to land on.
Yeah, that's right.
Yep. All right. So I was dialing up to. You offer a DVD that's got snippets from a bunch of the previous DXpeditions. If somebody wants to just get a survey of what's going on.
Yeah, and it's really designed to be fun, and you know, a lot of the little 5-minute segments in there are humorous and not radio oriented, just some of the guys cutting up and things like it. It's pretty cool, and it's fun to make it. Yeah.
Okay, and so also in between Desecheo and Navassa, was this little trip?
Just a little trip to the middle of the Indian Ocean. This is Amsterdam Island. I think it was ranked number 5, number 6 when we went there. And you see that boat in the background. That's the Braveheart. The Braveheart is the vessel of choice for expeditions in that part of the world. Unfortunately, we had to spend 8 days each way on the Braveheart. And that kind of complicated the trip.
Yeah, I'll play a little bit of this. I'm real familiar with the DVD because you sent it on to me, and I'm familiar with this trailer because this is one of the things that I did for you was I edited this trailer for that. And that's this and the Vassar are the only things that we've done together. So I'll talk about that in just a minute. But I'll let people
most of while you're on board, and it sometimes can be the most difficult thing to understand is the toilets.
After about a year and a half, we're on the way.
So it was a long sea voyage, and some of the places you go to are like that. You're going to be spending more time traveling than you are actually operating, I think.
Well, in this case, we were 16 days. No, I'm sorry, it was 9 days each way. So 18 days on the boat and 19 days on the island.
Okay, so about even.
Yeah.
This was another one of those places that was not all that uncomfortable to operate from because it was not only inhabited, but inhabited by gourmet chefs.
Well, they weren't all gourmet chefs.
One guy was.
But, the French contingent there, they don't go anywhere without their food and their wine and their cheese. And I think most of the guys gained a couple of pounds during our stay there.
So it's been rougher.
I've seen rougher trips, yeah.
Yep. Although the captain of the Braveheart was noting how nice it was to see he called you guys the Teletubbies.
Oh, that goes back to one of the first expeditions done with the Braveheart. And it's kind of hard to explain, but all I can say is that they were not allowed to stay overnight. This was on Campbell Island or Auckland. I guess it was Campbell. And so at the end of the day.
There's your gourmet chef there.
Yeah, there. Well, that's the gourmet bartender. So we had a chef, a sous chef, and a bartender, and then there were some other people there too.
Okay, watch this here. You lost a camera.
Lost a camera.
Okay, so you were saying the Teletubbies.
Well, I had to kind of understand what the origin of that was myself, but it was a trip that James Brooks put together, and I'm not sure of the year, been a long time ago. They hired the Braveheart to take them to Campbell Island, ZL9. And they had to leave the island overnight, go back to the boat, and they could, at sunrise, they could go back on the island. So they had on these orange old-fashioned big overalls, warm overall things that sometimes you wear in the Antarctic. And so they were all coming down the hill, kind of waddling down the hill to where the Zodiac was. And the captain just commented that they looked like a bunch of Teletubbies that he'd seen his kids watching on TV.
Yeah, this is the survival suit here thing here, but that's not what you're talking about.
No, this is a little different than that. But they're just kind of waddling down the hill. Anyway, that stuck. So we're all Teletubbies now.
Okay, so that's where that came from. Okay, let me head on back to the website, and we'll see what pops up above that. Oh, there we go. K1N. That's from last year. The Navassa DXpedition. You were the co-leader for this along with Glenn, right?
Right, right.
I think you were saying that there were a variety of groups or hams who were attempting to work through Fish and Wildlife to get permission to go, and it took a coalition to... Am I understanding that right from your talk at Dayton?
That goes back to the origins in the early, probably 1999 or 2000, somewhere in there. We came together. There were three or four groups who at that point were all trying to get permission. And, we just thought that it might be better if the ham radio community, the international ham radio community, was represented by one voice. So we all got together and decided that we would just, combine our forces and, represent, you know, DXers worldwide. And that was the origin of the KP15 project. So here's an example. We talked about this earlier. Here's an example of where folks were competing and they decided it was counterproductive and decided to instead, you know, combine forces, so to speak.
Successfully, as it turned out.
As it turned out. Took a while.
Yeah.
Long time.
What was I going to say? Oh, you had edited or produced these DVDs, this, you know, long list of DVDs down here, with one fella. I think his name is Ed.
Ed, yes. Yeah. Ed Boutwell, W4 Zulu, Sierra Bravo, or as he says it, W4 Zoot Suit Baby.
Okay. So, you were kind of shooting home movies. You got better at it as you went, but your goal was not to be the videographer on these. There was lots more to do than just shoot video, but you decided you wanted to shoot some video of them.
Is that a question?
Yeah, it could lead into yes, I did.
it's not why I was there, that's for sure. And I just, what I have learned just to try to capture things of interest. So, I may go days without picking up the camera.
Yeah.
But when I get a good editor working on it and everything, he can find enough things that fit together and make a good story.
Okay. And so I don't know if the editor on any of these is in any way the big deal, the star. I've been doing editing for all of my life. And most of the time, the editor for this or even a big time Hollywood movie ends up as a credit that floats up usually at the end, sometimes at the beginning of the movie. But Ed was no longer able to edit this stuff for you. And so you looked for somebody, and I had shot a couple of the Dayton talks with you. So you called me to see if I'd be willing to do it. And I made the mistake of saying I would.
Yeah, nobody was more surprised than I was, except maybe you.
Yeah. Well, you know, I saw your caller ID on the phone. I said, he's going to ask me to edit his Navassa video. And I could not turn it down. I don't have a strong presence in the DX community with my Ham Radio Now stuff. And I thought, well, these would be good credentials to get. It would be fun to do, and it would be a lot of work. And it turns out you sent me the tapes. You had shot about 5 hours worth of tape. Approximately 1 hour worth of that is the camera pointed at your lap or at your shoes.
I did that on purpose. Yeah. It was.
I do that all the time.
Well, no, it's a little embarrassing. In fact, if you got time for a side story here, sure. I took my camera to Bhutan in 2000, and I got confused as to what was on and what was off. So all my footage was of the ground, or you know, my pant leg or something like that, and all the good stuff, I turned the camera off. So as you say, I got better at it. But anyway, I finally only had about 3 minutes worth of usable video, so all the rest of it was not usable.
Yeah, well, I am a pro, and I do that all the time. And it's not, in this case, not getting confused about what's being recorded and what's not. But I'll pick up the camera and look at it and say, it's been recording. You know, when did I turn that on?
Yeah.
And there'll have been more than one time when I won't look and see that it's been recording, and I'll push the button and I'll go from recording useless stuff to what I want, which of course disappears. So, you know, someone's face will come up into frame and then blip, it's gone. And I won't know that, you know, until it's post-production time and, you know, time
too,
to put
too
things.
Late. That's right.
Yeah. So you can lose some pretty good intimacy.
While we're on the subject, Gary, I think you did a heck of a good job.
I am trolling for compliments here. That's pretty much the whole idea.
No, it, you really know what you're doing, and I won't say you made lemonade out of lemons, because the video was pretty good. But
if there hadn't been good material to work with, it wouldn't be a good DVD, and it's really
just,
good DVD.
You just did a superb job of putting it together and editing it, and I appreciate that very, very much.
Yep. Now, I'm guessing you had some trepidations as things were getting started. First of all, it took me a while to get the gears rolling. And then I started sending you first 2 minutes of the edit.
Yeah.
And then first 4 minutes. And I was able to do that. I put in a few hours a day, most days, and accomplished an edit of a minute or two. What did you think as you were starting to see this stuff? Different than what you had before. Not totally different, but a little different style.
You really are trolling for compliments, aren't you?
Yeah. Well, what I want you to say is, Gary, I was scared as hell. I had this, but I was getting scared at this stuff.
Well, I was beginning to wonder if we were going to get it done in 2015.
But nobody's ever called me fast.
But, you know, you had other projects you were working on. But once you got those cleared out and out of the way, and the way you did it, you know, a couple of minutes at a time, and, you know, so every day or every other day, I'd be getting another couple of minutes. Because it takes a couple of hours to do a minute. Most people don't realize that. So if this thing is 45 minutes long, you got at least 100 hours invested. Anyway, as it began to come together, I began to understand that this was going to be really, really something special. And it is.
And you didn't have very many things that you wanted me to change.
No. You, for not being a DXer, and maybe that's not the criteria, but I would have to say...
I've been a ham for a long time. I understand the concepts.
Yeah, and you know how to make it interesting and how to piece it together, and you know how to use some transitions that I'd never seen before. It was 21st century work. I loved it.
Yeah.
Still do.
And one of the things that we did differently than you'd done before. I needed a narration track to describe what was going on. And you haven't done a lot of narration tracks before. Again, most of them were what I would call a home movie-ish, in that you just presented what was there. Sometimes you talked to the camera. Sometimes you added a little narration afterwards. But for the most part, it was just what was there. I decided to go with narration, and I needed a narration track to be able to edit to. So what we do in the business is what we call a scratch track. I just recorded myself wrote some copy, and I would, you know, write 30 seconds worth of copy and then edit to it, read it and then edit to it, and then, you know, go on from there. So what we've ended up with is sort of an interplay between your voice and mine. We decided to use my voice for the off-camera narration, and yours, well, it's still off-camera, but it's recorded on site from standing behind the camera. And I really like the way that those two played together.
I do too. At one point, we were talking about me doing the whole thing, and you know, as things went along, I just realized just that your narration added so much. It was so much better than I could have done. So,
different, just different.
Well, it was clever. I mean, you've got a good sense of humor. I don't, and you know, I frankly didn't realize that when we first met, but you do have a good sense of humor, and it came across.
Yeah, I tried to make it fun, and I've gotten some email and some comments on Facebook. I think more from the trailer that we did. that said, you know, that I'm interested in this DVD because DXers usually and other videos I've seen just, you know, kind of stodgy old stuff. And this looks like they attributed my sense of humor to your whole group, which I think is not an unfair thing to do. It's just the group's sense of humor doesn't really come through very much. And so it was like, well, these guys are not taking themselves too seriously. And they don't. I needed to help put that in there a little bit.
Yeah, it was great.
You did, however, let's take a look at this trailer. When I first sent you the trailer, I'll play a little bit of it here.
Okay. I know what you're going to say.
Yeah.
In a world where DXers battle to work them all, one tiny island slowly rose to the top of the most needed list. Navassa. In January 2015.
So your comment when I sent you that was something to the effect of, I will grow to love it.
I think my comment was, "Where'd that voice come from?"
Well, you were not enamored of the trailer initially.
No, but everybody I showed it to said, "Bob, it's great. Get used to it."
Yeah. Well, I've been working with professional, you know, people in the advertising industry for a long time. I know the first blush is not always going to get through, but I had a little bit more leverage here because we had a very short amount of time to be able to get this done and get it out. And so I knew you couldn't ask for too many changes. So
you didn't exactly say, "Bob, I'm not going to change it," but you made it clear it's going to be a lot of work.
Yeah.
Bob Allphin presents K1N Navassa, the movie, or the DVD. Available at many fine amateur radio retail establishments or direct at NavassaDX.com.
There we go. Got your commercial today in there, too.
Yes, you did.
I missed the red booby part. I forgot to put that in there. No red boobies were harmed in making this movie. So we had a good time, and it finally got out just before Thanksgiving for the Christmas stocking stuffer holiday season. I mean, you sent me a pretty good sized check for my part of this. I was going to get a little piece of each one. You apparently have sold a few.
Yes. We've sold about 460. And, you know, I'm sure I guess people are curious, you know, what our expenses are and that kind of thing. The biggest expense is you. No. The biggest expense is postage. And then, of course,
especially worldwide.
The postage worldwide in particular. Yeah, it's not too bad shipping a DVD somewhere here in the States. But if you're going to go overseas, it's about half of the cost of the shipping is about half of the cost of the DVD. Yeah.
It has gone way up over the past couple of years.
Yeah.
Way up. And you're selling the DVD for $25.
$25.
Shipping included. So you're not putting a surcharge on it, even if it's being shipped to someone in one of those really expensive places. But the whole world, even Canada, is expensive now.
Yeah. Yeah. And there were a couple of instances where the person that ordered the DVD, and you do this, typically you do it through PayPal, said, you know, Bob, in my country, we've got a problem with the mail service. The only stuff that really gets through is when you send it registered. So I've sent a number of them registered mail. And of course, there's nothing left over after that. But that's not the purpose. We're not doing this to make money. We're doing it to have fun.
No, I'm in it for the money. I hate editing. No fun at all for me.
If there's anything left over, I just plow it back into the next DXpedition.
So let's talk some things that I learned as I was editing this. The Navassa DVD has about a 10-minute section in the middle, maybe even a little bit longer, of just pretty much pure you guys operating. And that's one of the things that was different than most of your other DVDs. Your DVDs have operating, but it's just kind of, it's inserted here and there. And last, 30 seconds, a minute, you'll see the guys operating a little bit.
Yeah.
I made the very conscious decision to put in a big slug of operating, a couple of minutes per operator, or not everybody's in there, but several of them. Phone, CW, and I put in one little bit of Lou operating teletype. Operating teletype is not a lot of fun to watch, but I stuck it in there to show it, that it's being done. And I wanted people to get a really good idea of what things were like, and that's one of the things that we negotiated in terms of how the DVD got prepared. Not just you, but just about anybody who's putting some video together of hams operating will cut together the good stuff and take out anything that didn't go right or anything that seems to be taking too long. And I said, let's show people what this is really like. Let's leave in the long gaps where you're trying to pull out a call sign and nothing is coming to you. And so you'll see a lot of that there in the DVD. But now you can tell me about it. We'll see as people let off the key after they've finished a contact, the din that comes back at them, whether it's CW or phone.
Right.
And sometimes there's a call. Sometimes you hear somebody strong, but a lot of the times nothing. You know, I don't know how you pick that stuff out. Just riff on that a little bit. Tell me how that works.
Well, first of all, I think one of the big attractions of going on a DXpedition, whether you're going to a hotel in the Caribbean or, you know, a top 10 DXCC most wanted, one of the reasons people like to do it is the challenge of handling the pileup. And you get, you know, obviously like anything else, you get better at it over time. And there's kind of tricks of the trade. I have learned that I am better off waiting until I get a full call sign. Let me back up a couple of things. Number one, the guy on the other end who's calling needs to understand that I really do want to get him in my log. And he has to help me. And there's a lot of ways there's a few ways that he can help me get him into my log. And at the same time, there's an awful lot of other people who are competing to get into the log. So we've got on both ends, we have to use our head. And what I try to do is I try to find a full call sign and go back to that full call sign and make the contact. There are some people who will go back to a partial call, and I do that sometimes. It just depends. But if I hear AQ, I've got an option of going back to AQ question mark, and then you say, "Oh, I think he's got me," and then you give KN4AQ, and then I do have you, and we exchange a report. Or
and you'll see some of that on the DVD.
Yeah,
you see operators who are doing it that way.
Or I hear AQ, and then I know that you're going to call me again. So I just wait until I hear you call me again, and then I go back to you with a full call. I've decided there's less time wasted that way. Again, it depends on the situation now. For example, on 160 or 80 meters, which is, you know, where I really, really enjoy operating on those low bands.
Because you're a glutton for punishment.
Well, it's just a matter of, you know, just kind of playing it by ear. But anyway, now let's talk about you or the other DXers who are competing to get their call sign heard by me. What you want to do is determine where and when you can call so that you have the DX operator has the greatest chance of hearing you. So, first of all, you don't call where everybody else is calling. I know that sounds logical and simple, but you should spend time looking around to find a frequency that is within the range that has been specified by the DX operator, a frequency where there are not a whole bunch of other people calling. Because if you watch the video, you'll see that instead of just moving up the band or moving down the band, there are so many people calling that what you do is you randomly tune through there till you find somebody you can understand. So pick a clear frequency and call there.
Yep. So I want to interrupt on those two things so that we don't get off of them before I can ask about them. On the giving your call sign more than once, as I understand it, the DX operator's code is just call once. So that's not going to work, at least for these enormous pileups. You don't want someone to go KN4AQ, 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 but you want them to give them their call and then maybe wait a couple seconds. And if you're not working somebody else, put in your call sign again.
Well, that's two separate calls.
Yeah. So that...
You see what I mean?
Yes. Okay. All right. So I understand that's not really violating the DX code. At least for maybe a more average DXpedition pileup situation, one of the complaints is that the pileup goes on forever and you don't want it to last forever. And if everybody gives their call and gives it again and gives it again, it just kind of gets extended. So those are cross purposes. You can't not do that, and yet it creates a problem.
Yeah. What you need to do, you, the caller, needs to do is put your call in and then see if he heard it. And put your call in and see if he heard it. And put your call in and see if he heard it.
Yeah. And so then if he's answering someone else, stop!
Precisely.
Jeez. And
so then the pileup doesn't go on forever. It stops pretty soon after somebody is pretty soon after you come back to somebody.
Yeah, okay. So it's only going on and on because you're trying to pick a call up out of the den.
Yeah.
That's what
the other thing I would suggest, because I understand that your audience, although I'm sure there are many DXers,
they're watching this one.
Yeah. Well, I hope so. For those that, you know, that are just getting interested in the game or trying to get DXCC for the first time, I said earlier, just want to find out how far their signal will go.
Yeah. You work 36,000 individual people from Navassa. 36,000 unique individual people.
That's right.
Many of them, you made 140,000 contacts, so many of them worked you more than once on different bands.
That's right.
But in those 36,000, they weren't all big-time DXers. There are a lot of guys who are just...
That's right. And frankly, that's who I want to work. I want to work the guy who's got 100 watts in a vertical, and it's a brand-new country for him. That's the guy I want to work. I don't want to work the guy who worked it 20 years ago and is now working on DXCC Challenge and wants to work on all bands. Yeah. The big thrill for me is for somebody to say, Bob, that was an all-time new one, ATNO. And frankly, that's what motivates me. I want those people to have a chance to work it. So while we're on the subject, again, you've got to, somehow or other, you have to make yourself heard. And if the DX station is listening between 5 and 15 up, split operation, between 5 and 15 up, why don't you call on 15 and a half or 16?
Because you're going to start expanding the...
Well, usually we've got these band scopes down there. And we see this massive number of signals in that 10 kilohertz spectrum. And then we see this little guy up a half a KC.
So you'll get him.
With a little signal. And I'm thinking, I bet he really needs me.
But then the next guy is going to go up another half a kilohertz. And the next guy is going to go up another half a kilohertz.
And then you go back and you start over again. I mean, you can't, in the military they call it mission creep. You can't have.
Spectrum creep.
Spectrum creep.
Just creep.
But still, you've got to do something. I want to get you in my log, but it's not just my job. It's your job too.
All right. And so in terms of, I have seen both of these, and anyone watching the DVD will see a guy will finish a contact and he won't even listen on that same frequency. He will dial immediately. And get something else. Yeah. Or he will stay on the frequency and a strong enough signal, sometimes a big signal, will come on and call. So what the pilot folks are doing is they'll find the frequency of the guy that you're working, and maybe they'll land right on that in the hopes that that's where you're going to stay. So in that sense, it's a crapshoot. You may or may not.
The way it's supposed to work is that you're supposed to listen. You know, the first rule is listen, listen, listen. We never tell anybody what they're supposed to be listening for. But what you should be listening for is the pattern that the DX operator is using. In other words, after a QSO, is he moving up a little bit? Or is he moving down a little bit? Or is he working two or three on that same frequency before moving?
Speaking of moving, I'm going to have to move you back to the center of the frame. You're slowly drifting.
Did I do that or did you?
I can't move you horizontally, so there you go.
It must be me. So now I lost my train of thought.
We're looking for the pattern of the...
Yeah, so once and then you position yourself. Again, you got to help. Make yourself heard. You position yourself ahead of the move. So if he's moving up after every QSO, a half a kilohertz, then you should call him up a half.
Okay. Now you're not going to have the advantage of watching the video of these guys. So you've got to listen to who they're working. You got to keep listening to the pileup side and say, okay, he's working this guy. Now he's working this guy. So now I'm going to go a little above that. And sometimes they do that. You'll see in the video, this is very instructive. Sometimes you'll see people tune a little bit, and sometimes they'll just spin across the pileup.
Well, if this is a normal sized pileup, and it's not a top 10 most wanted, it's easier for the DX operator to stay in this predictable pattern. In fact, it is recommended that the DX operator use a predictable pattern so that people can who understand what they're doing can get in and get out and go to lunch. But when you've got, a huge pileup, I mean, with literally hundreds and hundreds of stations calling.
And those are the only kind you ever see anymore.
Pretty much. So far, at least, the strategy here is that doesn't work because there's 50 people who are up one calling. So you do random.
You got a lot of smart people who know the technique.
So now you're
randomizing a bit more.
More and more becomes random. So if I was a little pistol, so to speak, 100 watts and a dipole some kind of restricted
setup. That's what you
setup.
See back there, 100 watts and a dipole.
Yeah, okay. I've been looking at your restricted situation there. you just need to find a clear frequency, and they'll find you. And that clear frequency may be in the specified range where they're listening, or maybe a little above it. I wouldn't go below it because that puts you closer to the transmit frequency of the DX station.
So typically when you work split, the split is going to be up above you. Is that universal or is that just usual?
It's most of the time That's true.
Yeah, because you always hear up five, never hear down five.
Yeah, and by the way, when you hear up five, that's not a complete set of instructions, as far as I'm concerned.
It's five plus.
Well, plus how much?
Yeah, there's another good question, because that's one of the edits that we made. I'm going to put you on the spot again here.
And these guys, you know, on this trip are, you know, some of the best in the world, yet somebody will say up five. Well, I'm trying to decide where I should call him. And he said up five. How's up 30?
Yeah.
So he'd be listening up 30. So what, you know, the way it should be done is I'm listening up 5 to 20, or I'm listening between 28,500 and 28,25.
Yeah.
I'm 28,500 and 28,525.
So I'm not going to put any. I'm not going to put anybody on the spot here, but I had an edit in there, and the guy's contact is still in the DVD. You're just not going to be able to tell which one it is because of my editing skills. But I sent it to you, and the guy had said, listening from A to B, and A was like 30 kilohertz below B, and you guys were trying to be good spectrum occupants and keep your pileups 10 to 15 kilohertz wide. So you said, now we just can't advertise that that's okay by having it in the DVD. So that got snipped out.
Yeah, it was actually 50 kilohertz.
I was trying to be nice.
But it was on 10 meters.
Yeah, it was 10 meters and it was above 28.5. There wasn't anybody else there.
Plenty of room up there. But yeah. Anyway, that's story for another time.
Okay.
We do have an obligation to be good stewards of the spectrum. I believe that very strongly.
Because you're not the only thing going on, and people get upset.
Yeah.
And you're somewhat sensitive to that. So yeah. What else? What other kinds of things should people know? One of the things that maybe not impressed is maybe not the right word. One of the things that clearly noted was that when you responded, or one of the guys, especially the guys who are responding to a partial call, sent that partial call out looking for that one guy, and the din level was here, and they sent a couple letters and a question mark, and the din level only went like that.
Yeah, they didn't go away.
And he tried it again, and you know, it went a little bit like that. Even when you call the whole call sign, and especially when you can see it's when you're looking at the spectrum scopes, especially on CW, the signals are very clear. So there's a spectrum scope full of these signals calling you, and you answer somebody, and you expect it to look like that, and instead, it still looks like this. There's still people calling like crazy. Yeah. What's going on?
And that's because they're probably calling two or three times, and they did not hear the DX operator go back to AQ.
So they were, I mean, they were just already transmitting. They were in the middle of their next transmission.
Are still transmitting.
They didn't hear it. So I guess, you know, not everybody's operating full QSK. They're not operating something where they can hear in between.
Well, CW, you should do that.
Yeah. You can't do it on phone.
Yeah.
Is it easier to pick people out on CW than on phone?
Much easier, yeah.
I noticed that everybody seemed to have a different philosophy of what filter bandwidth to employ.
Right. Yeah, and this varies by band conditions, by the band and the band conditions. What a lot of guys are doing now is letting their ears be the filter, so they're opening it up to maybe 800 or 900 kilohertz instead of 250.
This is on CW.
On CW or 400 or something like that. They're opening it up to 800 or 900, and then they're letting their ears do the filter.
Which is what people had to do, you know, until these really good narrow filters were available. It's what people always did.
Yeah.
Decades ago.
You hear so much more, and you get better at doing that after a while, and I tend to hear low frequencies, but sometimes if I open it up a little bit, I'll hear some guys calling that I need to work, who are just off frequency a little bit, and I wouldn't have heard of them without tuning, but I got them in the log, and they're gone to lunch, you know, or to another band to work.
Yeah. Do you ever make a mental note of somebody who's being maybe a little egregious, somebody who's stepping on other people and clearly doesn't care? All he wants is your call. And I'm thinking, and I shamed somebody on the DVD. It's pretty specifically, and I think it was during your contact, but it might have been somebody else's. The guy had responded to a W9X.
Oh yeah,
and called several times for the W9X, and then
and a W2 kept calling.
Yeah, W2 with a big booming signal right on the frequency. Yeah, was calling, and I put his call sign in big bold yellow up there just so people would know what's going on. Now, as you explained, well, he might have not heard your response to the W9X, although in this case, I think he probably did. And he didn't care. Just, boom, it's me, W2, and here I am. So I shamed him with a big fat yellow call sign on there. Has he sent you email yet?
You know, my strategy is to work them and get them out of the way.
Yeah. So I was going with this is, do you make a little mental note of people that are being butts and at least, because I remember Don Miller's talk at Dayton. He said he kept a little, sort of a list of people that were being bad, and he would not work them.
We just don't, I don't do that. I mean, I have called people down. But it's not like I don't work them.
Okay.
You know, he was saying he didn't work them.
Yeah. And then the absolute worst thing was you work them and don't put them in the log. That would be mean.
Well, I've never done that either. Okay. It's better to get rid of them.
Yeah.
And get them in the log and they'll go on fat, dumb, and happy. And you can worry later about why they were doing it. I mean, maybe they were using a code reader. Maybe he was calling three times in a row and he didn't hear me go back to the number W9 twice. I don't know. And I just know that after I worked the W9, I worked him and then he disappeared and I got back to work.
Yeah. How long do you go in a stretch working people and eating Fritos? That's an inside joke for the folks watching the DVD.
Well, until I run out of Fritos. I can't believe you put that in there.
You sent me a list of things that were on the raw footage that I got and starred some things. And you put in Bob Eats Fritos. And I think there might have been star next to it. I'm not sure. Yeah.
You put a star. I don't think I did.
I might have. It caught my attention anyway. It was fun.
Well, we're putting together a little contest trip to Sabah for the ARRLCW contest coming up in next month. And so decisions have to be made. We've got four operators. We've got two radios. It's going to be a multi-single. So you got... what's the length of the shifts? And I prefer, even on DXpeditions, I prefer 3 hours. After 3 hours, I'm ready for a break. And somebody who's been waiting in line to get on the air is ready to get on the air. I prefer to do it that way. Now, you know, when you're doing a real contest, you got to go 40 or 48 hours somewhere. And I don't really have an interest in doing that anymore. So, to answer your question, for me, the perfect time frame is 3 hours. However, on an expedition, when you're in the middle of the night and you got the low bands, you may very well have 2 3-hour shifts back to back. 6 hours at night, everybody else gets to rest. You're having fun because you're working 160. And in a 6-hour period, the propagation changes considerably. So you don't get bored. Not that it's boring, but, you know, there's always something interesting about to happen.
So that brought up two questions for me, only one of which I'm remembering right now, and maybe the second one will come back to me as we go on here. we were talking a while ago about the qualifications for being able to go on one of these expeditions. Well, health is going to be a factor, but what about just physical conditioning, the ability to handle some of these things? You know, some are harder than others. The guys going to Palmyra are going to get off a plane and walk across the tarmac, but the guys going to Navassa had to be, I was going to say pretty good shape, but they were going to be confronting some physical conditions, and you know, yeah, things are not going to be very nice. What kind of shape do you look for people to be in, especially now that you're all getting like deathly old? I'm 66. I can say that, guys.
Yeah, you can. Well, let's put it this way. It is a factor when you're considering the team. A lot of fellows.
Do people volunteer who just really shouldn't?
Yeah, there's some of that. It's not a big problem. The bigger problem is when you got a guy who has some experience, who has the time and he has the money and he's a good guy, but he's 100 pounds overweight. That means he can sit in the chair and he can operate, but he's limited in what else he can do. Now, I'll give you a perfect example of one of the ways to solve that. One of the guys who went to Amsterdam with us was overweight. And he lost 100 pounds so that he could go on the trip.
Good incentive.
Yep. Yep.
Go ahead.
Well, and I know that the owner of the Braveheart has said that he has the right to... Turn people away, yeah. Know.
All right. I remember the other half of what I was going to ask, and that is physical conditioning probably plays into it some. But most of the guys working you, or most of the guys working some of the big contests, are doing it from temperature-controlled climates in a comfortable chair, having beverages and all the stuff that they want to keep them as comfortable as you can for these huge, long endurance test contests. In Navassa in particular, it was miserable. It was hot, and you know, everything environmentally was working against you. How does that affect your operating ability? And what I might observe if I was looking over your shoulder trying to pick out these call signs and work people as fast as you can?
Well, that's another argument for three-hour shifts. Now, in my case...
Maybe 30-minute shifts.
In my case, now, I was probably the oldest guy on the team. Yeah, I think I was the oldest fellow on the team. So when they went down to Lulu Bay to haul water cans up, I did that once.
You tried.
At least I tried, and said, you know, this, I'm going to let you guys do that. And oftentimes after coming off a shift, I'll go lay down. If there's nothing to do except watch other people operate, I'll go lay down. And that's helpful to me. And I just happened to have a bunk by by a window where there was a nice breeze coming through. So I cooled off. There weren't any bugs. If I was hungry, food was 100 feet away. If I needed to go to the bathroom, it was 50 feet away. Probably should have reversed that, but... you know, you just stay comfortable. It was not that tough in my view. Peter 1 was tough.
Because that's the cold.
That was, you know, yeah, terrible. I mean, you couldn't go outside without putting on 5 layers. You had to go to the bathroom. You had to put on 3 or 4 layers. You know, it's just uncomfortable. I guess I can handle the heat better than I can the cold.
All right. We're running up on your time limit. You got some other stuff that you got to
do. Are we going to talk about these upcoming DXpeditions?
Sure. Yeah, I was going to say, whatever else you want to fill your time with. I get accused of interrupting people too much and not letting them talk. Because I'm the expert on everything. I hope I haven't done that too much with you.
If you weren't such a darn good editor, I wouldn't let you get into it.
But what else do you want to bring up?
Well, I want to mention four the expeditions that are coming up that should be of interest to anybody. Certainly, I think the DXers who are watching probably know about all this, but those that are, you know, maybe new to the hobby or don't know yet whether they're interested in DX and they're kind of kicking it around and seeing if it would be fun. You really, if you think you might be interested in working on DXCC, these are some expeditions you probably ought to try to work now, because it could be a long time before they're on the air again. First of all, starting January 11th. Now, I know that's tomorrow, but I think tomorrow the team going to Palmyra is flying from Honolulu to Palmyra. They will not be on the air tomorrow night, I don't think. But they'll be there for 2 weeks, starting either the 11th or the 12th. And that ranks number 9 on the most wanted list. And then January 18th or so, plus or minus weather, South Sandwich, the call sign is Victor Papa 8, Sierra Tango India. It's number 3 on the most wanted list. Again, South Sandwich, point your beam if you have one at about 150 degrees. If you have
up with these as fast as I can off of the web here.
If you have a vertical, point it straight up, I guess. And then that same team will be there about 8 days. This is pretty rare. It's it'd be a good one to have in your pocket. And then that same team is leaving and sailing 3 or 4 days back to South Georgia. They pass South Georgia on the way down. They go back then to South Georgia, and they're going to operate another 8 days there. South Georgia ranks number 8. The call sign is Victor Papa 8 Sugar Gulf India. And then in March, around the first week of March, March 6th, 7th, 8th, somewhere in there, again, weather depending, is the Heard Island expedition, the call sign Victor Kilowatt Zero Echo Kilowatt, and it ranks number 5. So in the next 60 days, number 3, number 5, number 8, and number 9 will be on the air. And, it's a good time to get them in your log.
Turn my volume down here. So I want you to hear me clacking the type, the keyboard. Is this a particularly crowded DXpedition calendar? Is this unusual to have this many in a row?
Highly unusual. Yeah.
Okay. Highly unusual. So it's going to keep people busy.
If you're lucky, in a year's time, you'll get maybe 2 of the top 10 activated. And here we have 4 of the top 10 activated in 90 days.
Any particular reason?
I think probably one reason is that if they wait any longer, conditions will continue to deteriorate.
Yeah, so it's sunspot related.
Sunspot related, but also, these things take a long time to put together, and it just so happens that they've all come together. You know, maybe that's a big reason as well. All come together about the same time.
All right.
But I know the VK0 Heard Island expedition has been planned off and on for about 3 years now, and finally got the right combination of people and transportation and money. So that's why that's happening now.
And the pool of people that are qualified to be able to do this is evidently big enough to stage all these together.
Yeah. I mean, there's not a bad operator on any of these teams.
All right.
They're all good or better.
You don't take anybody whose primary qualification is shooting video, do you?
We did to Peter One.
Really?
Yeah.
One guy's job was shooting video.
Yeah. And he got a free trip down there, and his camera broke on the second day.
I can bring 2 or 3 cameras. I'm just saying.
Oh, so you're fishing again, huh?
I'm not sure I'd want to. I don't know. Palmyra, you know, where you walk across the tarmac. Yeah.
That's your kind of deal. Huh?
But you don't need a guy to do video on one
of those. How about the hotel in Jamaica? How does that appeal to you?
Yeah, that sounds pretty good, too. I'll be good. Bob Allphin, thank you very much. By the way, I apologize for slightly mispronouncing your name in the narration of the, you never called me on it. It's Allphin, not Allphin.
That's right, Allphin.
But
A-L-L-O-P-H-I-N, yeah. Finn. And I want to thank you. I had no idea that this was going to be so all-encompassing.
That's what we do here on Ham Radio Now.
Well, I like that. And
yeah, not one of these five-minute things on Ham Nation. No, you get the show.
I think they do a great job as well.
They do.
So thanks.
I like needling them, but they do a good job.
Thanks for having me on. I appreciate it. And we'll see you again soon.
Still here. You're still here. All right. Thank you, Bob. And thank you, Angel. And that will be it. I think we've done all we need to do, except that last final reminder that Arvin is still the taskmaster over my shoulder. HamRadioNow.tv. Stop by. And to help us out financially, yes, Bob sent me a nice check for working on the Navassa DVD. That was last year. This is this year. Still have rent to pay. I don't have rent to pay. This is Cindy's house. She owns the house. Mortgages. No mortgage. Mortgage is paid off. Taxes and homeowners association dues. We figured out that the taxes and homeowners association dues on this house equal what I used to pay for rent for an apartment not too long ago. And everything else is, you know, theoretically free and clear. Cindy's going to go, why is he talking about our stuff like that? Because I want you to stop by and see Arvin, HamRadioNow.tv, and help me out. It's more than my radio fund. It's real stuff. What else? Oh, that's it. There's other stuff going on, but that's it. I got to get back to the Tapper stuff, and there's some things floating around for this parody act that I stuck a program in on. But no one's watching here anyway, so you don't care. I will see you on the next show. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ 73, over and way, way, way out, long time ago.